an academic biology research paper can be pretty intimidating. But if you take the time to learn the structure or the general moves these papers typically make, it can be a little bit easier. Unfortunately, this means you first really need to learn how to read a biology research paper. Sounds like a lot of fun, huh? So to put this in perspective, writing a biology paper without understanding the structure or first learning how to read one would be like walking onto a golf course without understanding how the game works at all. You'd have this huge course sprawling out before you with all these possibilities, with the endpoint nowhere near in sight. So simply put, learning the structure helps orient you to the action so you can learn to make meaningful moves of your own. A biology research paper generally has four major sections: the dance section, the beer pong section. No, that doesn't sound right. So a biology research paper generally has four major sections: the introduction section, the materials and methods section, the results section, and the discussion section. And when done well, these sections make up a really nice hourglass structure. I'm borrowing my hourglass structure from Dr. Joshua Schimmel's book, Science Writing: How to Write Papers That Get Cited and Proposals That Get Funded, which I would suggest checking out. And I'll leave a link to his book in the description. Basically, his hourglass structure would be like the layout of the golf course or something like that. And now the moment you've all been waiting for. We're gonna look at a biology research paper and look at some of those elements and how they fit into that structure. You guys ready?
So the paper I've chosen to look at is Temperature Controls a Latitudinal Gradient in the Proportion of Watershed Nitrogen Exported to Coastal Ecosystems, written by Sylvia Schaefer and Merrill Alber, because it's one of my personal favorites. No, that's not true. The reason I chose it is because it has a bolded introduction section, a bolded methods section, a bolded results section, and a bolded discussion section. And it's important to note that not all biology papers have these bolded sections, but they all make these same moves. So I thought this would be a good paper to show you how they all fit together.
So let's look at the introduction section. The introduction section makes four important moves, but the first thing it does is it introduces the research topic and it establishes why it's important. So basically it creates a hook and then it creates immediacy for the reader.
For example, the transfer of nitrogen from one ecosystem to another is an emergent property that is of fundamental importance, as export from one system becomes input to another. Given that upstream sources often dominate inputs to coastal areas, nutrient transfer between watersheds and coastal ecosystems is an issue of particular relevance. In these two sentences, the authors have established why their topic of research is of fundamental importance and of particular relevance, or they quickly explain what their paper is about and why it's important to read.
The second move the introduction makes is the literature review, which provides the audience with the expert background information they'll need to understand the gap in knowledge that the research is addressing. Now, it's important to remember, you don't just review the literature, you use the literature to define the problem and the questions that your gap in knowledge will be addressing. So let's look a little bit at what they've done here.
So in the literature review portion of Schaefer and Alber's introduction, they cite the work of other biologists to define the problem and the question that their paper will be addressing. So essentially, they're defining or highlighting the gap in knowledge that their paper will be looking at. For instance, this first sentence defines the problem. There have been several efforts in recent years to develop relationships between watershed input and export to the coast for different areas of the world. And in the next section, they define the question that the paper will be looking at, or one of the questions. However, the mechanisms that control the proportion of N exported remain poorly understood. And they make these moves all throughout their literature review.
They basically write, these experts have said this. However, we see this other important thing going on. That's the difference between reviewing the literature and using the literature. That's a really important thing to remember.
And the third and fourth moves that the makes is doing the substuff.
So the third move that the introduction makes is introducing the methodology or methods. And then it moves on to stating the hypothesis, which is the question that the research is looking to test. So let's check it out.
So here they introduce their methods and methodology. In this article, we apply the scope methodology to 12 watersheds in the southern U.S. and develop N budgets for the same base year. We use our results along with those from the scope project to describe the relationships between input and export of nitrogen to coastal watersheds on the Atlantic coast of the U.S. These next two sentences state their hypothesis.
We then develop the argument that temperature, by affecting denitrification, exercises a primary control of watershed and export. We expect that this hypothesis will generate further investigations of the biochemical controls of N export from watersheds.
That the introduction makes these four important moves is why it is wider in the hourglass structure. It grabs the reader's attention, it defines the problems in the question, and draws their attention to that gap in knowledge. To go back to my golf metaphor, it makes sense of that wide open golf course by orienting the reader or the player to the significance of the game, the actions, and the direction of play.
Now let's look at the materials and methods section. The materials and methods section and the results section both make up the narrowest part of the hourglass structure, and that's because they detail the action and the results of it. So the materials and methods section pretty much does what it sounds like it does. It lays out all the materials and all the methods you use to conduct your study. The idea behind this is that so somebody else can replicate your study if they wanted to. This would be like laying out all the golf balls and the golf shoes and the golf clubs and detailing all the shots you took on the course or the, what are they called, strokes you took on the course so that somebody else can replicate your game. It's the same idea. But I'm not going to go over all the ways they do this in this paper, mostly because I don't really understand how they do that. But this is a good place to talk about a few things that are really important to think about when you're writing an academic biology research paper. And the first thing is brevity is king. You want to write as concisely as possible. One of the best ways to write clearly and concisely is by favoring the active voice over the passive voice. So the active voice is when the subject is doing the action. The girl hits the golf ball. The girl is the object doing the action, as opposed to the passive voice, which is when the subject is receiving the action. The golf ball is hit by the girl. The golf ball is the passive subject receiving the action. But this distinction is a little more nuanced than I'm going to get into. So I'm going to leave a link in the description to a video that gets into this in more detail than I could or have. So another thing you can do is avoid using contractions. A contraction is when you use an apostrophe to contract two words, such as they've, it's, whose. So contractions are considered informal, and avoiding them can make your writing more professional and more emphatic. It also could help you lean towards using that active voice. Now let's move on to the results section. So the results section is where the authors lay out the results of their studies objectively. This would be like showing the audience or your golf buddies, your golf scorecard. Just show them what you did. But seriously, in the results section, biologists detail what they found. And then in the discussion section, they interpret those results. So the results section lays out the raw data, and the discussion section interprets those results. So now finally, let's look at the discussion section. So in the discussion section, that hourglass figure, it opens back up. And that's partially because, or mainly because, the author's voice comes back in as the results of the study are interpreted. So the discussion section makes three important moves. It interprets the results, it refers back to the literature used in the intro, and it ends by placing the paper's contribution into the bigger picture, or it ends with a conclusion. So this whole section essentially is like interpreting all the strokes and all the things you did on the golf course, for better or for worse, and then relating that to the greater game of golf. So let's look at how Schaefer and Adler refer back to the literature they used in their intro in the discussion section. In their intro, Schaefer and Alber write, however, the range of proportional export span from 10% to 40%, suggesting that 25% value may not apply to all regions. And then in the discussion section, they respond to this, writing, the results reported in this study, an average of 9% nitrogen export in the southeastern U.S., are far below previous goal estimates of 25% export. Although it may be that different mechanisms become important at a global scale, it is likely that some of the scatter observed in other studies, individual watersheds vary from 10% to 40%, here they are again citing Boyer, is due to the temperature-driven differences such as those described here. Now the last important move the discussion section makes is placing the paper's contribution into the bigger picture. This is really the conclusion. So just as your intro establishes why your area of research is of greater importance, In the conclusion of the discussion section, you're looking to place your paper's contribution into the bigger picture.
For example, at the very end of their introduction, Schaefer and Albo write, "We expect that this hypothesis will generate further investigations of the biochemical controls of an export from watersheds." And then, at the very end of their discussion section, they write, "The results presented here also imply a connection between climate change and eutrophication." In this conclusion, they're addressing the further implications of their paper's contribution, which they hint at the end of their intro.
So it's important to remember that you don't necessarily have to prove something prolific in your discussion section. You just need to interpret the results as truthfully and professionally and mindfully as possible. Because even finding the same thing as a previous researcher is a valid contribution in and of itself. You could be validating what they've done, or you could be opening up other important questions. In that sense, it's just as important, or it can be just important, to understand why something did work as it could be to find out why something didn't work.
And there you have it, the full hourglass structure of the academic biology research paper: your introduction, materials and methods, results, your discussion section, and then conclusions and implications.
So now that you've mastered the moves made in the academic biology research paper, go out there and make some moves of your own. What are you waiting for? Go on, I'm done. Get it.